Welcome back to the Cambrian. I'm your host, Homo Habilis. What's that? My producers are telling me Homo Habilis is a bit too late for this time period. In fact, any hominid is? Okay, any mammal. What would a human be back this far? Well, here's mammals, and we'll throw in reptiles and birds and fish for good measure. All five clades, actually. Okay, and in the Cambrian, that looked like this. So I'm your host, Pikaia Grasslands, and welcome to the Cambrian. So Earth is very different at this time, and life is very different at this time, although I suppose what Earth looks like isn't super significant because everything lives in the water. So it might be relevant to first look at the origin of the names of various aquatic animals, which are not as obvious as those of land animals. First of all, a lot of animals are just found everywhere, so expect a lot more Indo-European names. Secondly, since a lot of fish are similar, they tend to have modern science-y names, and by that I mean Greek. Enough yapping, let me do a survey. Here are 100 animals that live in water, and I took the origin of all of their names. What sticks out? Well, a solid half of them are straight English in origin. Not Old English, Modern English. Something to the effect of sea slug or dogfish. In the absence of terrestrial species, we can probably ignore this category. Beyond that, there really seems to be no logic whatsoever. Crab, bass, smelt, eel, and minnow are all native. Okay, fine. Dace, carp, and mackerel are all Norman. Why? What's so special about these? Goby, mullet, and perch are all Greek. There is no logic. Perch and bass are the same animal. And wrasse and char are from Celtic languages. Sure, there is at least something to be gained from the non-European named, of which there are 10. The manatee, which is not found in Europe, has a Caribbean name, as does the barracuda, which is found in Europe. Dugongs are only found in the Indian Ocean and Cebuano in name. Wobbegongs are only found around Australia and have a Tarug name. Betta are found in Southeast Asia and have a Malay name, as the gurami, which is found all around Asia. Piranhas are restricted to South America and have a Tupi name, as are groupers, which are found all over. What that basically represents is a divide between tropical and temperate fish. Looking at a modern map, tropical regions are... This is North America, Siberia, and the rest of Russia. China, which is jumbled up. The Middle East is here with India split by the projection. And over here is Antarctica and Australia. So those are going to be the tropical fish, while temperate fish will be European, which is here. And here, and here, and here. And then there is the third category of freshwater fish, which are very restrictive, but this is the Cambrian. There is no freshwater here. It's Panthalassa. You are going to evolve for a marine environment. So we start with the one you've all been waiting for, Anomalocaris. The phylogeny of Lobopodians is very screwy, so the best I can do is a vague description of plated body, two-fang-looking things, with Anomalocaris sharing its common name with Peitoia and Amplectibellula, the former of which is found in Poland, firmly temperate enough for a Proto-Indo-European name. Even though these fang-looking things are not fangs, a hornet's horns are not actually horns, so I will name it the one who has fangs, which in this case is Tequo. Actually, this just means the one who has the things that pierce, but you get the point. This becomes Proto-Germanic Dikion, the nasalization added by analogy. This is the descendant of this ending. Anyway, yeah, West Germanic gemination, and then the y drops off, and the ending vowel denasalizes and shortens and drops off, and the stressed vowel shortens, so we get... Actually, let's use a different root, because this is already the name of a fish. So, petio means the same thing, that's bidio, and the same story, so we land on bid. So, Peitoia is the European bid, Amplectibellula is the Pacific bid, and Anomalocaris is the anomalous bid. Next up is me, represented as Pikaia and its ilk. Pikaia is a chordate, so it's defined by having a notochord, as well as some other things I don't super care to get into. The foremost ramification of this is that its body is less flexible, but also less floppy, so it can wave it around. In the context of the ocean, that means it can swim like an eel. That's pretty unique at this time. Most of the other organisms of the time are benthic, living exclusively at the bottom and perambulating across the seafloor using rudimentary limbs. Hence the names. Pikaia can swim freely throughout the water column, which means it can feed on plankton, which is fascinating and all, but people are hardly going to name an animal after the fact that it feeds on plankton. No, they're going to name it after the other thing I mentioned, which is that it lacks those rudimentary limbs everyone else uses. Pikaia is streamlined using only a dorsal fin. However, all early chordates, at least the ones I have on my list, are tropical species, mostly from China. So how do we get the names of Chinese animals? Mostly Tibetan, as evidenced in Yak, Panda, and Takin. Tibetan is also not a good language to find resources is, but the Chinese word I'm looking to translate is hua, which is roughly slippery or smooth, and that becomes Tibetan dred. So I'm not opposed to using dred as the common name, potentially spelled like the verb, but most likely not. So Pikaia is the Chinook dred, Cathamyrus is the two-horned dred, it's sometimes reconstructed with antennae, Hycoichthys is the one-fin dred, contrasted with Millocunmingia, the two-fin dred, and Yunanozoan is the striped dred. Fish tend to be named after their coloration, which makes it very difficult for me when I have no idea what color they were. Let's move back into the Lobopodians with the spiky worms. Once again, these are found in the tropics of Western Canada and China, so this time I'll go with Western Canada. Now, the exact location of Western Canada is underwater. The closest land is over here in Saskatchewan. However, humans would be Pikaia at this point and therefore also underwater, but I'm just going to put humans on land. The language spoken here is Tenesuchline, aka Chipewyan, which is a bit easier to get notes on. The Chipewyan language for any sort of wormy fish, eel, leech is Hutui, and there are a few options for needle like Thutil, Algare, which is pine needles, and Dagore, which is thorn. I'm going with the pine needles because it seems the most evocative. I think this comes in the order of Hutui Algare, which I would ideally shorten into Huddlegar, potentially by analogy to Gar the fish, but those don't exist yet. So Hallucigenia is the dreaming Huddlegar, and Lolishania is the transaltaic Huddlegar. Did somebody say Lobopodians? Next up, we'll move on to the ones with a hyoid mouth. Pambdelurion, at least, is found in Greenland, which is relatively close to Europe, to say nothing of the Indo-European homeland, but I'll at least be happy with a Norse name. So the open mouth parts remind me of yawning, but there is the minor problem that the Norse word for yawn already exists in English. Well, Norse isn't the only source of northern animals. Words like gull, penguin, and really a lot of birds are all from Celtic languages. Unfortunately, I couldn't find a proto-Celtic construction of to yawn. However, we do have the modern Irish mianfach, which is kind of similar to the Scottish Gaelic mearanach. So with the agentative suffix, I predict something in the ballpark of mianair, English manner. So Pambdelurion is the European manner, and Omnidens is the Chinese manner. So, a lot about the precursors to arthropods and chordates. What the heck about molluscs? Well, the soft-bodied protostomes of the time are Odontogriphus and Wuaxia, the menstrual pad and the pinecone with spikes. We'll start with Odontogriphus, which is from the Burgess Shale, home of the Shuswap languages. Yes, I know last time I went with the Tenesuchline, but whatever, I want variation. The Shuswap for flat is Spal. Honestly, I'm fine with just spal as the English loan. I could go with flat worm, but that's too long and has too many P's, and also the number 7 is here. So Odontogriphus is the Olympic spal. Over to Wawaxia, it basically just looks like a pine cone covered in pine needles, so I'm fine with sea pine. Wawaxia will be the red-tipped sea pine. Yeah, I know, I said I wasn't going to do that, but so back to Lobopodians. We did the Huddlegars, the worms with tentacles and spikes, but what about a worm with only tentacles? Of these, Xenusion has been found in Germany, so another Indo-European name is in order. Fish names tend to be more indirect, mostly because trout are less obvious than wolves, bears, or tows, so I'm going to name it in Proto-Germanic rather than Indo-European, using the logic of Ovatio Vermis and calling it the celebrating worm. In Proto-Germanic, that's Dulfivurmish, though it may be more unpredictable considering Dulfiana never made it to English, Old English Dilthwirma, English Dilthworm. However, considering build and other oath words in Proto-West Germanic, and also Werner's Law and Dulfiana, Dildworm seems slightly more likely. So Xenusion is the Baltic Dildworm, Microdictyon is the Chinese Dildworm, and Ovatio Vermis is the Checkered Dildworm. It is probably important to do trilobites, and I'm sorry, but these will all share one name the way crabs do nowadays. Trilobites are most notable for their shells and eyes. Sure, Anomalocaris had a cuticle, but trilobites had honest exoskeletons. The PIE word for bone is huest. Give it a feminine ending, huest, yeah. Proto-Germanic asti, Old English este, Modern English est. Add a prefix so it means surrounded by bones, amest. Probably respelt as amest or amest. So, Redlichia is the Mediterranean amest, Elrathia is the Pacific ameth, Olenoides is the rock amest, and Olenellus is the false rock amest, and Paradoxides is the puzzling amest. A lot of these are taken from their current scientific names. Say, where are the hemichordates? No, those are different from real chordates. You will never be a real chordate. Anyway, these are jellyfish right now. More specifically, a lot of them working together make up one jellyfish, although that's how some jellyfish work too. I mean, graptolites actually have very little in common with jellyfish besides a convergent shape. Each one of the tentacles is actually an individual worm-like creature with a giant bulb protecting them at the top. Also, they're tiny. Not that Cambrian organisms were that big, but these guys would only be the size of flies. Sea flies, final answer, no. Obviously, if a fly lived in the ocean, it would be called a swim. The example genus I have is Diplograptus, which lived pretty much everywhere over its periods-long lifespan. Allegedly, they use their cilia to create currents that drag in prey. In human terms, I think we would experience them the same as burrs, in that they get stuck to you whenever you go swimming, so to stick, which is bleh. Suffix that with, I don't know, tus, that's the ending used to form Diplograptus, double hook, even though Latin grappo never existed, it's from Frankish. Whatever. Proto-European glechtus, Proto-Germanic clithuj. The oblique stem is clithuj if you prefer, but I like this one because it becomes Old English clitho and Modern English clithe, so Diplograptus is the common clithe. Hey, have you guys heard of this group called Lobopodians? Because we have antler worms next. The closest to Europe is Hadranax, found in Greenland again, and this time we'll go with a Russian name vis-a-vis beluga. So pretty much every animal with horns has a Slavic name relating to ker, the Proto-Indo-European word for horn, so I'll just make up a new ending based on English heart, a kind of deer. Proto-Balto-Slavic, something like sirudas, Proto-Slavic sirdu, Modern English sird. Potentially spelt as seared, I certainly would like it to be spelt that way at least, so Hadranax is the Arctic seared. I know Greenland isn't in the Arctic yet, but whatever. Aishaia is the collared seared, and Genshanapata is the decorated seared. Maybe it's weird to lump in Aishaia with those, but Lobopodian phylogeny is still a mess. We're running out of time, so no more connecting sentences. Back to Lobopodians. Opabinia, weird eyes, weird proboscis thing. In British Columbia, lots of languages. These two I've already used. Athabascan, Salishan, neither. Stony or Nakota. Dictionary. Eyes. 5. Istathapta. Istathapta. Istapta. Istap. Opabinia can be the elephant istap. Elephants do not exist yet. Morellomorpha, trilobite, but three-dimensional. Trilobite is amest, or bones around. Maybe bones in front can be Marella, four est. That is trees. Also, trilobites are Europe, but Marella is tropical, so Canada or China. Tagalog. Forward star is cabitin, Spanish cabitin, English cabitin. Marella is the spiny cabitin. More Lobopodians! These have two arms. They were only like two fossil digs from the Cambrian, so these etymologies are fine. I just didn't think they would be Chinese. Malay is another common source for animals. Grab, snatch, seize. These are all not on Wiktionary. Indonesian is basically Malay, and it has kedut and rampas. The pang in pangolin means er. So either pengedut or pengrampas. Pengrampas can shorten into perrampas, which can turn into English peramp. Leanchoilia is the slim-fingered peramp. Hycocaris is the short-fingered peramp. Isoxes is maybe here as like the stout peramp, or maybe not. Naraoya is like an amest, but short. It only has two segments. Make it the fool's amest. Fuxianhuia is kind of similar to an amest, but it's a lobopodian and had a giant tail. Okay, instead of bones around, how about bones behind? This prefix is hind, so hindest, or maybe hindemest. Feels nicer on the tongue. Fuxianhuia is the sailor's hindemest, Sydney is the broad hindemest, Wathia is the stargazer hindemest, and Canadaspis is the motherly hindemest because its lobes look like booms or some such Freudian nonsense. And that leaves Eldonia, by which I mean I am leaving Eldonia. Do you want it? I don't. Nobody cares about Eldonia. Merry Christmas.